here on BBC Two in the Mayfair set.
Britain's power and influence has declined since the beginning of the century. And the question is this a trend we can reverse?
We are concerned with making money. That is what we're trying to do.
It's been described as the most beautiful terrace house in London.
The abuse of business and financial power.
You lied.
We shall have a harder Christmas than we have known since the war.
Economic activity is best left to the private sector, with market forces being encouraged to operate.
The summer of 1976 was one of the hottest on record. Berkeley Square in Mayfair became infested by a plague of caterpillars. They got everywhere, even inside the Claremont Club. One of the few Claremont members left in London that summer was James Goldsmith. Every day, he and his mistress, Lady Annabel Burley, went to the High Court. Goldsmith was suing the satirical magazine Private Eye for libel. They had alleged that he had helped another member of the club, Lord Lucan, to escape. Goldsmith saw it as a battle against a corrupt, liberal establishment in Britain.
Isn't it rather curious for somebody in your position, with your public reputation, with your massive industry, to start fussing about what one or two journalists say about you in the press?
Well, you see, this is where we profoundly disagree. Tolerance is a tremendous virtue. But the immediate neighbors of tolerance are weakness and apathy. Now, unfortunately, small, subversive groups have been allowed to infiltrate all sorts of the activities of the nation, vital parts of the nation. And most people like you, like you're suggesting, are suggesting be tolerant. Well, I'm suggesting to you that tolerance of extremists who are trying to destroy our society is not a virtue. I believe that it is cowardice and treason.
In 1980, Goldsmith left Britain in disgust and went to live in America. His attempt to destroy Private Eye had failed. He had been forced to settle and had nearly bankrupted himself in the process. But Goldsmith had arrived in America at a moment when an extraordinary political change was about to happen, and he was going to get caught up in it. He would be used as a battering ram to break down the old system of power that had ruled America for 50 years. The conscious shaping of society by a corporate and political elite would be destroyed by people like him and replaced by the blind force of the markets. And out of this revolution was going to come a strange new world that no one had expected. A world in which everyone worked to one end, to create as much money as possible for those who no longer worked, the old and the dying.
Economic ills we suffer have come upon us over several decades. They will not go away in days, weeks, or months, but they will go away. They will go away because we, as Americans, have the capacity now, as we've had in the past, to do whatever needs to be done to preserve this last and greatest bastion of freedom. In this present crisis, government is not the solution to our problem. Government is the problem.
Nancy, 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 with a laughing face.
Ronald Reagan had come to power at a moment of economic crisis, and he promised a dramatic regeneration of the country's fortunes. But not by government, which he blamed for having led America into the chaos. His solution was to give power away, to Wall Street and to the financial markets. He wanted them to find a way to regenerate America. It was a moment of great opportunity for Wall Street bankers. And one of them, a young man working for an obscure bank called Drexel Burnham, seized the moment. He was Michael Milken. He had invented something he believed could regenerate America. It was a way of raising vast amounts of money for the sort of businessmen other banks would never touch.
What we offered them was a more powerful financing mechanism than anybody had ever seen before. That would allow them to dream bigger, to do things that they could never have done before, to take off the fetters on their mind, the financial fetters on their mind. Take them off and visualize something that you could do if you had 30 or 40% more money.
Vegas.
What Milken had invented were called high-yield bonds. He had already used them to raise millions of dollars to build new casinos in Las Vegas. Casinos were the sort of projects traditional bankers wouldn't touch because they were too risky. But Milken had shown, by statistical analysis, that actually it was worth making such risky investments. Because of the risk, you could demand a very high rate of return. And although some of the businesses would go bust, if you invested widely enough, on average you would make a fortune. At the same time, outsiders were given access to money previously denied them by the traditional banks.
In the past, pre-Milken, capital was in the hands of the very wealthy families, the very wealthy and old institutions in America. They're the ones that had access to the great capital, and for the younger entrepreneurial or the companies or the entrepreneurial men and women, it was very difficult to get access to that capital. The long road was to become a public company, and then maybe someday you could raise money. And what happened when Milken did his thing and introduced all these elements and mixed them together is that we had the democratization of capital. Capital no longer belonged to this very elite and small group. It was available to everybody.
The established banks called Milken's technique junk bonds. But by the early 80s, they had become a great success. Milken had created scores of new millionaires, and investors were falling over themselves to invest in junk bonds. But to Milken, they were more than just a way of raising money. Junk bonds were a powerful weapon with which to challenge the established power of Wall Street.
I don't think it was greed. A lot of people think it was greed. I think it was power. A lust for power drove him. I mean, I think it really made him, you know, feel like, you know, he felt he had a kind of a messianic thing. He really felt he was making a new world in Wall Street, and that he, you know, was its arbiter.
You ain't seen nothing yet.
You ain't seen nothing yet.
You ain't seen nothing yet.
In Reagan's New America, Milken realized that the junk bond would become all-powerful. As one of his first acts, Reagan had loosened the rules governing the takeover of companies. This meant that Milken, using the vast amounts of money he could now raise with his high-yield bonds, could attack the giant corporations of America. It would be highly risky, but Milken was convinced that hidden away in the corporations were assets he could turn into fantastic profits for his investors. But Milken needed frontmen, ruthless, greedy outsiders he would fund and who would fight the vicious takeover battles for him. And in New York, he found the perfect candidate, James Goldsmith.
I believe in change, and I believe without change, you have decadence. Is it a coincidence that companies like the Bank of America, even General Motors, all these huge American companies, not to speak of the British ones, and not to speak of the ossified French ones, are becoming less and less competitive because they haven't dared undertake change? So if the choice is the harshness of change or the softness of no change, the ultimate result of the latter is infinitely worse. It's like saying it's too harsh getting up in the morning, why not stay in bed? It's very harsh and dangerous to go out into the street. It's exactly as though you said, in nature, there can be no continuity in nature because of their predators. And in fact, there were some game reserves set up by some well-meaning people who said, this is horrible, these poor animals should live constantly under the threat of predators. Those animals subsequently became degenerate and died because predators are a necessary stimulant. And if you eliminate predators in business and just create comfortable bureaucracies and monopolies with no predators, you will have a dead industry. The prosperity of the country will shrivel away, and your people will suffer infinitely more than by being subject to the constant stimulation of threat and competition.
Well, he was a very egotistic type of man. He knew what he wanted. He knew what he wanted to do. And he didn't have great respect for most of the managements that he started to go after. And he thought these companies were sitting ducks, which they turned out to be.
Good management does not stop at the mill door. A company picnic is a common example of industry as a social enterprise. And there's nothing cynical in saying that this pleasant scene of people eating barbecued chicken is a symbol of good business. For good fellowship begets cooperation. And cooperation is what turns out more and better goods, means more sales, more profits, more wages, and more fun for everybody. The highest standard of living in all history has been earned, bought, and paid for by a system in which our vast industrial resources are but the generating force of the greatest social enterprise the world has ever seen.
The big corporation was at the heart of American life. It was far more than just a way of making money. The idea of the corporation had been born 50 years before, out of pressure from politicians. They had wanted to find a way of protecting America from the growing chaos of the free market.
I believe, and I've always believed, and I always will believe, in private enterprise as the backbone of economic well-being in the United States. People of America have no quarrel with business. They insist only that the power of concentrated wealth shall not be abused.
Roosevelt spoke at a time of economic chaos in America. The stock market crash of 1929 had led industrialists to sack millions of their workers. America was torn by riots as workers protested against this ruthlessness. The corporation was deliberately designed to stop it ever happening again. In future, industry would be run by professional managers, not the owners. The managers would not have shares in the business, and they would run it in the interest of everyone involved. The greedy, dangerous power of the shareholders would be controlled by this new structure.
Power passed into the hands, from the hands of one man. There were no women, or not many. Passed from the hands of one man into a structure, a bureaucracy. And that is the modern corporation. It is a great bureaucratic apparatus to which I gave the name the Technostructure. The modern corporation is a group exercise, and power depended on position and not stock ownership. The shareholder is an irrelevant fixture. They give the symbolism of ownership and of capitalism, but when it comes to the actual operation of the corporation, as has been agreed for many years, they exercise very little power.
Goldsmith and Milken now set out to take over the Technostructure. They would do it by borrowing billions of dollars with the promise that they would repay vast interest. They were confident they could do this because hidden away within the giant corporations was fantastic wealth which they could unlock and sell off. In 1984, Goldsmith and Milken made their first major assault. The Crown Zellerbach Corporation owned vast forests throughout America. From the timber, they made many of the paper products sold in America and employed thousands of workers. The Zellerbach Corporation was run from San Francisco by an elite group of international managers.
There was a very strong sense of social responsibility, very strong. There was also a sense of power for the sake of power, no question. People love power. Everyone likes to be power. And their power was very powerful because it didn't come from the amount of money you got in your bank account or your assets. It came from a whole empire that was there.
Goldsmith and his team went to the Crown Zellerbach headquarters to make their initial bid. The world they stepped into was the opulent existence of a patrician elite who had run America for 50 years.
They had the most luxurious, lavish facilities that I've ever seen. It was sort of typified by lunchrooms which were presided over by a rather handsome waiter and rather handsome waitresses, and when you went to have lunch, you weren't offered, as you normally were, sort of a drink. You were asked in a rather pompous way what ambiance you would like, which puzzled me at first, and then I found they had some silly machine which you switched on and you could have the noise of the tide coming in, or you could have autumn rain, or you could have the birds twittering. You know, you could eat your lunch against the background. It was nonsense.
What about the shareholders?
Shareholders are very passive people, as evidenced by the fact very few people sign their proxies. They either are living off it, they're retirees, and they're living off the income, or they're money managers. But there's no direct tie with a company. Look at the attendance to a stockholders' annual meeting as a classic example of, they don't really know about the company, or if they do, they believe it's doing well and don't bother to go to the meetings. They're passive holders at all levels.
I think they started by treating us with total contempt, you know, as if this could never happen to them. You had the syndrome of the head of Brown Zellerbach, I think, probably was reckoned to be a godlike figure by about a quarter of a million people. If you really added up all their present employees, their relatives, their past employees, their pensioners, everything. I mean, he was a big figure in San Francisco. They were sort of impregnable. They were part of the scene. They weren't. And so this was shock treatment. When we first went there, we were treated with contempt. There was nothing, just brush us aside as if we were flies, you know. And so it was a shock when they found that we were serious.
Crown Zellerbach was no match for the power of the junk bond. Using the borrowed money, Goldsmith simply bought up the shares of the corporation, and there was nothing the managers could do to stop him. Overnight, he became one of the biggest landowners in America. Goldsmith immediately began tearing the corporation apart. He sold off factories and sacked thousands of workers. He did this to pay back the interest. He also made a vast profit for himself. But to the Drexel bankers, it was the reconstruction of America by the power of the market.
Hostile takeover, okay? Hostile to whom, okay? It's not hostile to the shareholders, the owners, okay? It's not hostile to the workers.
Except for those who got sacked.
It's not hostile to them. I wish to God that we'd had a hostile takeover movement in the 50s. We'd still have a steel industry to speak of in the United States of America, okay? We exported all those jobs to Southeast Asia because we wouldn't make the decisions within our corporate structure here. And everybody says, oh, bust up, junk bond, hostile takeover? Give me a break. Wordsmithing. It's not what happened at all. The market works. The economics make it happen, okay?
Goldsmith now became one of the leaders of the hostile takeover movement. Obscure entrepreneurs, guided and funded by Michael Milken, began to take over the old corporations of America. However big the target, Milken was always able to raise more than enough money to to snap it up. And as each corporation toppled, a plaque celebrating its downfall was made by the bankers.
These represent some of the deals that Drexel did. These happen to be my clients, a small number of Drexel clients that we financed, and represented up here is close to over 4 or 5 years, close to $20 billion of financing. An example is the National Can deal of $365 million for Nelson Peltz. There's a different tranches of financing for Ronald Perlman of Revlon, which comes to $3 billion approximately. Most of these were all debt deals that Milken created for the 80s.
Chunk bonds.
Yeah, high yield bonds. We can say chunk bonds, we can say high yield.
You prefer high yield?
Doesn't matter now.
What Milken personally built was a network that in effect operated like a takeover mill. You know, identifying, teeing up, and blowing away companies. Identify them, tee them up, blow them away. Identify them, tee them up, blow them away. Milken was in control of the entire process. He was like the commanding general of the armies. Goldsmith was like one of his important weapons, but only one. You should think about Goldsmith as a transitional figure, one of the agents of the change, one of the principal agents prying the levers of power from the hands of corporate America and government and putting it into the marketplace, to the day-to-day decision-making of people in the stock market.
Goldsmith's aim was to get as much money as possible out of the corporations he took over, both for the shareholders and for himself. To do this, he systematically stripped out any excess costs. He employed a man called Al Dunlap to do this. Dunlap used a new name to describe what he did. He called it downsizing. Dunlap's nickname was Chainsaw.
I was the first executive who was really doing downsizing on a large scale and was willing to talk about what I was doing, how I was doing, and was also willing to articulate the fact that this is necessary. We were operating on sick companies, cutting out the cancers. Sometimes it could involve as much as 30-35% of the people. And of course, one must close some of the operations that should have never been opened. Our people that we were concerned about were the shareholders, the people who owned the corporation, the people that owned it before we bought it, the people that were investors with us, because we felt the shareholder owns the corporation.
Fever on an eight, taken 5,000.
Can I give you a couple of thousand, like 5,000?
Outside of us on a half bid, there's about 9,001.
Come on, pick up the phone.
Downsizing became one of the most important factors fueling a boom in the American stock market. Every time the raiders sacked workers and managers, their share price soared. And in turn, that pushed the bull market even higher. To the Reagan administration, it was proof their policies were working. The market was reconstructing America.
The American economy is like a racehorse that's begun to gallop out in front of the field, driving the bears back into permanent hibernation. That's our economic program for the next 4 years. We're going to turn the bull loose. Pull it back.
The market is in control now. Management was in control. The establishment was in control, full stop. Nothing happened if they didn't want it to happen. The capital markets were over here. They were quiet. They were passive. They were nice enough, but they weren't right. Now the capital markets are in control. They're saying clearly, loudly, and often, we own these companies. You fellas will perform. And if you don't, you're out because it's our property. This was unheard of then. Absolutely unheard of. You couldn't get the capital markets to go along with anything because they were captured by the management. Amazing change.
It's getting to be a disaster. You know, I mean, people just out of work. And there's nowhere you can find work. Food stamps going out. The relief program is going down. There's no work nowhere.
You're in restitution, sir. The restitution clerk will give you your check and your receipt. Just step aside.
As the takeover boom grew, millions of workers were downsized. Whole towns were decimated when the factory that had once been their main employer was closed. Ever since the war, management consultants had argued that one of the main functions of a corporation was to create jobs. But now, overnight, a new breed of consultant appeared, who explained that these layoffs were necessary.
For 40 years, for 70 years, for 80 years, we have attempted to rationalize and make bloodless the practice of professional management. Maybe that was appropriate 70 years ago, but in today's volatile environment, it just simply will not work. It is the most frightening, scary environment that I know of. Further, it has led me, for instance, to welcome the role of such dubious characters as the corporate raiders and their hostile takeovers. Throughout the economies of the industrialized world, we are beset with a degree of ambiguity, uncertainty, and madness never before seen, and I thus wholeheartedly welcome anyone of any sort at any time in any place who will scare the wits out of the still at the sleep at the helm leaders of our larger firms.
I think up to the point in time the takeovers came in, management consultancy existed to reinforce and serve management. I think it now exists to reinforce and serve the capital markets, the capital system.
But there was a growing backlash against Goldsmith and the other raiders. It was led by politicians whose power was intimately bound up with the fortunes of the large corporations in their home states.
Senator Worth, we have been arguing, it seems to me, for almost 100 years in this country about the responsibilities that corporations have to their communities. I mean, we have tried for a long time to get corporations more responsible. We've now done it at Peachtree. We're reaching out, supporting this university, supporting cultural activities and so on. We are the ultimate of what America believes corporate responsibility is. And you lawyers from Wall Street are coming in and telling us what to do with our community and our responsibilities. Now, we're going to make it as difficult as we possibly can for you to get this to happen.
Sir James?
The sort of stuff that Senator Worth believes in, which he just talked about, which is a pastoral America with a little company and the church and the university, and the whole thing is going to stay there and be there forever, and that they don't have to compete with anybody, and that competition is awful, and totally mixing up. Totally mixing up. This is the fundament. The difference between doing business and doing good. Doing business is what gives you the fuel to do good. Don't mix them up. The bee doesn't make honey because he's doing good. He doesn't have soul searching, am I doing good when I make honey? And he's confusing it, and that's why this country is losing its vigor.
One of the largest owners of shares in corporate America were the pension funds. They invested billions of dollars in the stock market to provide pensions for retired workers. The funds had been deliberately created as a part of the post-war corporate utopia that took care of workers. But now, the funds became important weapons in the takeovers. They were offered much greater return on their investments if they backed the raiders.
Well, the raiders, on the whole, were not viewed with a lot of friendliness, let's say. A lot of them seemed to be mostly out for themselves and would proceed in their raiding activities even if it meant damaging companies that had long histories of good employee relations or long positions of importance in their local communities or whatever. But nevertheless, for the pension fund manager, that meant that in some cases the value of stocks was increased and the pension fund benefited from that. And the people that were in charge of the pension funds had to go along with that because that was in the best interest of the beneficiaries of the fund.
Well, there was a lot of talk by major corporation executives who would say, you pension funds are selling out America. You're destroying our major corporations. You are selling out to raiders who are going to destroy us, and this is terrible. It's bad for America. That was the pressure coming from the business side, and it was a business pressure from CEOs and business organizations and so on. And the pension funds were accused of providing the grease over which this entire takeover movement slid. They were the enemy.
The quiet men who ran America's pension funds found themselves in a terrible trap. The law that had created the funds explicitly said that their duty was to get the highest returns they could, provided the investments were not too risky. But by now, Milken's junk bonds seemed to be a safe investment. so the pension funds began to buy them because of the fantastic returns. But in doing so, they gave Milken even more power to pull apart the very thing that had created them, the corporation.
The law didn't specifically say support the Raiders. What the law said was that the pension fund fiduciary had to act in the exclusive, is the word in the law, the exclusive interest of the participants and beneficiaries of the fund, not in the interest of the company that set up the pension fund.
Milken getting access to pension fund money was the single breakthrough event that took him from a powerful, fast-rising force to the dominant force in the takeover boom of the 80s. That was the key, because he had really tapped a $600 billion plus source of funds that no one else in that deals business had managed to tap.
And when you got hold of that?
Well, there was nothing that could stop it.
We in Europe have watched with admiration the burgeoning of this mighty American economy. There is a new mood in the United States. A visitor feels it at once. The resurgence of your self-confidence and your national pride is almost tangible. Now the sun is rising in the West. Many of the policies you are following are the policies we are following. You have brought inflation down, so have we. You have declared war on regulations and controls, so have we. Members of Congress, that is what capitalism is, a system which brings wealth to the many and not just to the few.
The takeover boom had by now spread to Britain. The large companies that had dominated British life since the war were being attacked and torn apart by a small group of raiders. They were led by another member of the Claremont set, James Hansen. He was a close friend of Goldsmith's, and like him was a true believer in the power of the free market.
The market is it. Absolutely. It's the greatest thing in the world, that free market. I love it. I love the idea of being a, that's what the argument I used to use when people objected. How dare you come and offer me to buy my business, they would say. And I said, but look in the paper, you're for sale. It says there that your shares are valued at £1 each. Doesn't that mean that I can buy them or sell them? Well, that's an argument you can't refute. So that's what the market's all about. I love it.
As in America, hundreds of factories were being closed and thousands sacked in order to maximize the return to those who had backed the raiders.
The sacking, or the downsizing, I think the Americans call it, of companies means that the bottom line nearly always improves. Profits nearly always improve because you get rid of one of the more expensive overhead items, which is wages.
And your share price goes up.
And your share price goes up. And you make money, institutions make money, the banks make money. The only people who don't make money are the employees who've been put out of work. But it was the hardest bit. I mean, the redundancies, you're putting people out of work, I mean, knowing that 3 months' time they'd be out of a job. That was tough. But it had to be done. Now, the corporate raiders didn't take that view at all. They took the view that if you put people out of work, you increased your profits. And they were right.
And caught up in this reconstruction of Britain were yet again the mild-mannered men who ran the pension funds. They could not refuse the raiders' offer of vast increases in their investments.
When you'd seen someone like Hansen make a string of takeover bids and apparently squeeze out quite useful profits, and he then comes along with another takeover bid, and you see that you've got a potential 25 or 30% gain on that, and the management that's in place has been presiding over declining profits for the last 10 years, suddenly tells you that it's going to start performing well. It's a little bit difficult to believe them and to turn down that financial gain.
the way it was done was not attractive, because individuals got them, managed to get themselves pretty wealthy in the process.
But did that matter to you?
No. As again, the test was the bottom line on the value of the funds, and that had to be the test. And the acid one. If somebody got rich as a result, it's not for us to make the moral judgment. Personally, I didn't find that at all attractive.
But that didn't matter. Your duty was what?
Our duty was to the members. Absolutely, all the way through, our duty was to the members.
We were there managing investments on behalf of our schemes. We were not there to re-engineer Britain. That was not the job we'd been asked to do.
But you were being used as an agent to re-engineer Britain.
In part, yes. But that's totally out with our control. What we were doing was simply managing our investments. In the best way that we could, as we'd been trained to do.
By now, the man who had started the takeover boom, Michael Milken, had become one of the most powerful men in America. In 1985, he hosted the annual High Yield Bond Conference in Los Angeles. But everyone called it the Predator's Ball. All the raiders came there to pay homage to the man who is using them to change the shape of America and making them billionaires in the process.
We had 60 people in 1980. And a lot of the people in the room were Drexel people. That's how small it was. In 1985, 5 years later, we had 3,000 people and hundreds of companies presenting and hundreds of companies coming. So 3,000 people moving there from 85 through 89 when it all ended. So that was a snowball effect. And it reached the point where if you were any entrepreneurial guy in the world, you had to be there. But you knew we had the ability to finance whatever you were looking at. So it just snowballed. I mean, it was just, it was standing room only. It was the toughest ticket to get in the world.
At the end of the conference, all the guests were treated to a video designed by Milken. It showed his vision of the new America that was being created by the destruction of the old corporations.
Perception. And reality, to accept change, to resist change. High yield bonds.
And as it ended, Michael Milken received the final blessing.
And out walked Frank Sinatra. Frank Sinatra walks over to Michael Milken and he says, "Hey," he says, "aren't you that junk bond guy?" Michael says, "Yes, I am." He says, "Here, make sure I got plenty of junk bonds." Walks further on the stage, the curtain opens, his 22-piece stage band, Frank Sinatra turns around, he looks out and he says, "Start spreading the news." I was 15 feet tall. Nothing bigger was ever going to happen in the world. I mean, it was amazing. You know, we had come from nowhere and we had Frank Sinatra and his stage band and he's saying, "Start spreading the news. Come on, get out of here," right?
Well, people are upset by vulgarity. And vulgarity is to some degree a sign of vigor. It means that new people coming from nowhere are making it. It's the old American dream. Anybody can become a millionaire. So if we want change, if we want vigor, we're going to have vulgarity. It's one of the things which irritates, but which is necessary.
Milken destroyed a world that was run by privilege, by old school ties, by professional politicians, and turned it into a free-for-all where the marketplace decides day by day, even minute by minute, who will have power, who will have wealth, and who will not. Milken surely understood his power, but he felt that it was in the end a benign power, a power that was better for the country that he was exercising that power than that he were not. Because he really felt he was democratizing the process of the getting of wealth and power.
Yeah, it's going up.
It's going up.
It's all going up.
James Goldsmith was by now one of the richest men in the world. He was worth over $2 billion. He lived in New York in a large house built specially for him in the heart of Manhattan. It remains empty today, 2 years after his death. But Goldsmith was beginning to suffer from delusions of grandeur. He forgot that he was no more than a creature of the banks. And having taken over control of industry from the state, he decided he now had the power and the money to take over foreign policy as well. And the first thing he decided he would do was undermine the Soviet Union. Goldsmith believed that the growing anti-nuclear movement in the West was completely controlled by the Soviet Union. So he, and a number of other right-wing tycoons, set up a private organization to undermine the peace movement. Goldsmith was going to privatize Western intelligence.
Privatized counter-subversion was the attempt we made to take over the job that had previously been done by our counter-subversion service, which was MI5. And we were able to do that because we had support from a number of tycoons in different countries who aimed at the collapse of the Soviet system. I hesitate to reveal who other people were apart from Jimmy Goldsmith, who supported us. But I dare say, given the passage of the years, that Rupert Murdoch would not object to my mentioning his name.
We shall overcome, a kind of unofficial anthem of the world peace movement.
Goldsmith's main target was the World Peace Council, an innocuous and ineffectual organization. But he was convinced that it was a sinister Soviet front. He spent millions of dollars on a series of deep undercover operations to try and expose this.
We managed to infiltrate the whole setup in a way which took the communist organizers completely by surprise. For example, when the World Peace Council meeting started in Copenhagen, two of our members had a banner, a very broad banner, which they unfurled, and they walked towards the podium so that the people in the audience could see behind what was written on the banner. Welcome to the KGB's peace conference. And of course, there was a lot of laughter, a lot of shouts of indignation on the part of the communists.
We can and shall save this world and save our children. Our children shall live, shall dance, shall play. All the children of the world, all the children of all the countries.
Obviously, when Jimmy Goldsmith and other supporters of ours heard about this, they were delighted. And they felt vindicated. They felt that they had been supporting the right organization.
Goldsmith's attempt to bring down communism was little more than a joke. But he increasingly saw himself as a powerful spy master. He paid for defectors to fly over to America on Concorde, where he personally debriefed them. One defector, called Oleg Bitov, wrote a description of his meeting with Goldsmith.
James Goldsmith, тот самый, у которого в руках было пол Америки. Он сидел, положив нога на ногу, и жевал сигару, толстую, как фабричная труба. Окружение было соответствующим. Подлинная мебель времен Людовика XV, скульптура Бенвенуто Челлини,
Вот только книжные полки были пустоваты. Пара детективов да биржевой справочник. Он был убежден, что врагов коммуниста вполне можно победить универсальным оружием, бездонным кошельком. Иллюзии своего всемогущества и тщеславия не имели у Голдсмита пределов. Вот и сейчас он выпустил клуб сигарного дыма и, решив продемонстрировать свое влияние, предложил устроить мне встречу с президентом Рейганом. Он даже поднял телефонную трубку, хотя это был уже чисто театральный жест. Из газет я знал, что Рейган только что утром отбыл в Европу.
Goldsmith's belief that he was powerful was a fantasy. The men who really had the power were the bankers. They were using Goldsmith's bullying nature as a weapon to break down the corporations. But the bankers themselves were about to fall from grace, and Goldsmith would be left helpless and exposed. It began with a Wall Street dealer called Ivan Boesky. He had become one of the most important figures in the takeover movement. The moment he heard rumors of a takeover, Boesky bought millions of shares in the target company. The raiders needed them, and Boesky then sold them on for a vast profit. He constantly searched for the slightest clue to a takeover.
Information to Boesky was everything. He had immense computer intelligence network. He had paid spies everywhere. One of his operations was said, for example, to track the movements of all the corporate jets in America, airport to airport. There was, because each of these jets has a registration number, he would have people find out what the registration numbers, which corporations' registration numbers in all the major airports in the country for corporate jets were. And those movements would be tracked by somebody in Boesky's pay.
Boesky had also created a system of informants inside the Wall Street banks. He bribed bankers to tell him when a deal was being planned and then bought shares. It was called insider dealing, and it was illegal. But the bankers could make a fortune on the side. And by the end of 1986, Boesky had an intricate, corrupt network, which included even the most powerful bank of all, Drexel Burnham.
Did you know that that sort of insider dealing was going on around these deals?
I knew it, yes. I mean, I knew it all the time. I formed the conclusion very shortly after I arrived in America, and we always acted on this basis, that in general, the American investment banking community was not immoral, it was amoral. Some of the people in the most highly respected places were doing this. And, of course, where there is so much money to be made, everybody flourished. Everybody made money.
Did you and Goldsmith ever do anything corrupt?
No. Not consciously. Or unconsciously. Why did I qualify that? No, we didn't.
Then suddenly, in November 1986, Boesky was arrested. It was also revealed that he had done a deal with the authorities. In return for naming all the bankers he had bribed, he would receive a lighter sentence. The New York District Attorney revealed that the takeover movement was riddled with corruption.
As a result of his cooperation, we are examining things that we weren't examining before. And you know we wouldn't have been doing it without Mr. Boesky, because it was going on before and we weren't doing it. As a result of his cooperation, a substantial systemic problem in the financial community was revealed, and revealed in a way that moved us to try to make changes.
Very suddenly, this whole other life of theirs is being revealed. Very often, for the first time, to numerous, numerous colleagues, to their family, sometimes to their wives. And that's a shattering experience. In fact, they're seen usually as very shrewd, very capable, very industrious, and yet there's this whole other side to their life in which they're cheating and lying and stealing, which they keep secret.
Boesky's arrest came as a shattering blow to James Goldsmith. He was in the middle of the biggest takeover yet attempted in America, for the tire company Goodyear. It had caused an outcry, and the revelations of corruption in the takeover movement gave politicians the chance to try and reassert control. Goldsmith was summoned to Congress to explain what he would do to Goodyear.
You're deciding how Goodyear ought to operate, and my question is, who the hell are you?
Mr. Sebeling? I made it quite clear in this document, Mr. Sebeling, that I was an active investor, and I'm happy to define what I consider to be the role of an active investor.
I hope you'll make your response brief.
I will do it by this answer, and I hope it'll be clear to you. An active investor is not a manager. He is not a particularist. He's not a man who thinks that he can double-guess management. He's not a person who thinks that he can do the job of management better than the manager that he can hire.
But that's exactly what you're doing.
I'll tell you what. No, sir, it is not. What I'm saying is an active manager has to ensure that the right management has to be in place, number one. That the right management has to be properly motivated, number two. That the right manager, properly motivated, then runs the company according to a reasonable strategy and not trying to chase after all sorts of industries it knows nothing about. That is a job of an active manager, of an active investor. If he does not consider the management right, he fires it and replaces it.
Now, I presume that the purpose of your acquisition of this company was to end up with a profit for yourself. Isn't that really your interest?
I can think of no other reason for doing business. And I strongly recommend that the United States, which was built on that idea, remain on that idea.
But,
it's very worthwhile. It's built
you
a great
recognize,
nation, Congressman.
Let me ask you one other thing. Mr. Boesky owns 300,000 shares of Goodyear, which he acquired recently. Has he been in communication with you on this transaction?
No, sir.
Thank you.
Goldsmith's power was now waning. Under political pressure, he withdrew his bid for Goodyear. But the revelations of corruption started by Boesky kept growing. They now spread to Britain.
At Westminster, MPs have been debating insider trading, that is, using confidential information to make money on the stock market. The debate followed yesterday's announcement of an inquiry into the Guinness Company. It's thought one area of investigation will be the activities of the American financier Ivan Boesky. He's already been fined $100 million for insider dealing in American shares. Today, the Labour MP Robin Cook linked Mr. Boesky's activities with the recent takeover by Guinness of the Distillers Group.
He was particularly active in the Guinness bid for distillers. He built up a very large holding in distillers, which is rumoured to have reached the figure of $100 million, a figure which he assembled well in advance of the announcement of the bid.
As in America, the Guinness scandal exposed a network of illegal share dealing. But unlike America, only four men were convicted. Evidence of a much wider system of corruption was quietly buried. One of those charged in the Guinness affair was the banker Lord Spens.
Well, I was part of that. I mean, I felt rather as though one had put one's head above the parapet and had it shot off. The failure by people to stand up and be counted was stunning. The city retreated into a shell and started to go into denial mode and say, we never did this, we never have anything to do with any of these practices. It was astonishing because they all had been.
Everyone had been doing this?
Everyone. Absolutely everyone.
Shit!
They haven't done anything
for today.
What? 5518!
That lady did.
Then finally, Michael Milken was charged by the SEC, the Securities and Exchange Commission, with 94 counts of fraud, racketeering, and insider dealing. He was sentenced to 3.5 years in prison.
Who did it? I think it was corporate America. I think it was some of our competitors who went to the SEC, which we know is a fact. And I think it was the factor of jealousy and envy. We just became too powerful in their minds. And those were the forces that finally got to us. That's what it was. It was the establishment of the real money in America versus the new money. That's what really became the force that went after us. And we were taking business away from everyone. You know, when we did all this business, someone lost business.
And you were changing corporate America.
And we were changing corporate America. All the companies who said they wouldn't touch a junk bond, all the great names in Wall Street, are all in that business today. It was like they picked up our business after we went down.
You bitter about it?
No. The only thing I'm bitter about is we didn't fight. To me, you know, there's a thing like death with dishonor.
The Raiders' day was over. But the revolution they had started was unstoppable. And the most unexpected group now took over the reins of power, the pension funds. The Raiders had shown the pension funds how to squeeze vast amounts of money out of the corporations. It was what the law told the pension funds was their duty. So they now copied the Raiders, but on a much greater scale.
The pension funds finally became Raiders themselves, or at least the functional equivalent of Raiders. They felt, well, wait a minute. If we were to exercise the kind of power Raiders did, we wouldn't actually have to take over the company. We could force them to do all these kinds of things that would make the share price appreciate in much the same way, and we could take those profits instead of letting people like Sir James Goldsmith and his ilk take them.
And is that what they did?
That's exactly what they did. It's what they've been doing since the late 1980s. The great irony of all this is that the pension funds were creatures of workers, of their power to force management finally to take account and take responsibility for them in their retirement. But now, after these tremendous upheavals in the market that began with the takeover boom, we find pension funds in the vanguard of people oppressing the very workers that they were born to serve, eliminating millions of jobs, holding down their wages, all in the name of higher profits so that they may have a more comfortable retirement.
It got to the point where we could not do a deal. It was impossible. And I remember walking in Central Park with Jimmy, and he said to me, "My dear boy, you know we'll never do another deal in America." I said, "I know that." He said, "People have gone mad. They don't care about the debt. They don't have people to run the companies. The bankers have gone mad. The lawyers have gone mad. We will never get a company because we will not pay so much that will fail our investors." So he said, "It's over." And he said, "This is the end in America. The 80s are going to come to a close."
In 1987, Goldsmith sold everything. He retreated to the remote jungles of Mexico. He used his fortune to begin building a vast private estate. It would be a world completely under his control. Goldsmith had been pushed aside by the large financial institutions he had helped to bring to power. They now ran American business, and his time was over. But Goldsmith was determined that one day he would return and reassert control.
Nelly the elephant packed her trunk and trundled back to the jungle. Off she went with a trumpety trump, 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 trump. The head of the herd was calling far, far away. They met one night in the silver light on the road to Mandalay. So Nelly the elephant packed her trunk and said goodbye to the circus. Off she went with a trumpety trump, 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 trump.